century was startled by the alarm of a fire that did not exist. Whoever had instigated this prank, the confusion it caused was a prologue to other events that same night. Events later to be known as the Boston Massacre. Together in rebellious groups, such as the Sons of Liberty. The colonials were further angered by this sign posted on the night of March 5th, which purported to announce the Redcoats' determination to repulse any opposition. Sometimes this opposition took the form of children's pranks, and sometimes it was the harassment of individuals.
Evening, your lordship. You want a job?
I have a job.
The job is one you're well fitted for, your lordship. Cleaning my privy.
Stand aside, man. I have better things than fight with you.
Now, don't be hasty, lad.
Stand aside, man.
A disorderly mob was roaming the streets of Boston. Trouble was brewing. John Adams, then a young, successful lawyer and a militant foe of the English crown, was to be faced with decisions that could have ended his political career.
John, I found this torn down.
I don't think the soldiers posted this.
Who then?
Oh, someone who wanted to provoke an incident to get rid of the soldiers.
Your cousin Sam.
I have no idea.
Method fits, Sam Adams.
It fits half the province. Come and try the Madeira, Jonathan. It's a gift from Mr. Hancock.
Some of his contraband. He owes you more than this for winning his case. You defended him very cleverly. I should know you forced me to drop the prosecution.
You had little choice. As Attorney General, you hadn't a case.
Sweet. Like most illegal pleasures. John Hancock brought this in without paying duty. He broke the law.
A law made in England. In Parliament, where we have no representation. John Hancock was never allowed to vote for that law, nor for any man to make such a law for him.
Enough, John. You are not in court.
He's arguing a case that he's already won. Does that mean that you have doubts?
They cannot continue to do it, Jonathan. Don't they see that? In England, a law cannot be passed without the participation of the people. We are Englishmen. Why are we denied the rights of Englishmen?
I have no answer to that, but I have a suggestion.
I think it is time for me to say, I hear one of the children. Will you excuse me?
You look lovely in that gown, Abigail. Does your husband tell you how beautiful he thinks you are? He tells me.
He saves those compliments for juries.
It's a palpable lie. Your head is constantly turned by my flattery.
What do you offer, Jonathan? It comes clothed as a suggestion.
The office of Advocate General to the Admiralty. Governor Hutchinson is prepared to recommend you to the King. Approval will naturally follow. You know what this means, of course.
The patronage of the Crown.
All the paces and appointments at the King's disposal. In 6 months, you'll have the most lucrative practice in Massachusetts. Advocate General is only the beginning.
And what would be the ending?
To a man of your talents, there's no limits to how far you can go.
Governor Hutchinson knows my political sentiments. He knows I belong to the Sons of Liberty.
You've stung him too many times for him not to know. But you'll have liberty to entertain your own opinions.
I can continue to think as I please.
The governor has no desire to influence you. He considers himself cursed with a brace of atoms. Sam to fan the flames of sedition and you to justify them legally. Between the two of you and your Sons of Liberty, you've already sent one governor scurrying back to England with his tail between his legs. Hutchinson has no desire to be replaced.
So I can become rich and secure and still keep my opinions. Unfortunately, opinions are followed by actions.
Those are ruffians out there, John. You're not that kind of a man.
I, too, must act on what I believe. And the Sons of Liberty believe that Englishmen here have the same rights as all Englishmen, including the right to protest against the Crown. Now, if I represent the Crown, I must put behind me all my friends and ideals I care for most in this world.
Let us be practical, John. I know your ambitions. I know you want to stand for the legislature. So you need the votes of your friends. The mob, the Sons of Liberty, or whatever you call them.
There is a difference between the Sons of Liberty and the mob.
But they will all still be your friends, John. Just as in court, you have acted against me. Politics has nothing to do with friendship.
Nor with principle.
Particularly not with principle.
You were always more cynical than I, John. Ah. I know you call it practical. But I call practical only what a man can live with. I hold the colonies unjustly held by the Crown. Am I now to benefit from that injustice?
It's not of your making, John. You are not responsible
for... I am responsible for myself. Did you really think I could be cozened like this? Did Governor Hutchinson think I'm a fool as well as a knave?
You're becoming emotional, John. It's always been your Achilles heel.
Well, I cannot accept your offer.
Then know what you reject. The law, John. The law which you claim you love.
I cannot love a law that serves injustice.
You cannot be a lawyer and serve lawlessness.
I serve those people victimized by laws I do not respect.
You cannot serve two masters.
Then I will serve justice.
John, I haven't been this impassioned since those old debates in Worcester. I shall leave you now, John. I shall not take this as your final word. I know you too well. I know that your principles do not condone violence.
Condone it? I despise it. It fills me with shame for the human race.
Yet that is where your side is taking you. I think when you realize that, you will realize where your real place is. And I do not think you either a knave or a fool. Pray, convey my respects to Abigail.
John? You will be late for your club. What did he want?
He offered me the post of Advocate General to the Admiralty.
Did you accept it?
No. Well, these boots are unmanageable.
If you would try putting them on before you put on your coat.
A man dresses from top to bottom, not upside down like a woman.
I doubt whether you have ever seen a woman dressing upside down. Maybe you don't need your boots. The snow is fast melting.
When snow melts, it turns to water. I've no desire to sit all evening with wet feet. You know how I catch cold.
Be careful how you go through the streets.
I'm protected.
You heard the trouble outside the house.
I'm protected.
Against nature, not against men.
Men are part of nature. That's why they have natural rights. You should hear me argue in court more often.
And from what we hear, even some members of Parliament are on our side. John Adams, you know that Dr. Franklin warned them that if they sent redcoats to America, they would not find a rebellion, but they would certainly create one. We are constantly receiving letters from the colonies of New York, Virginia, and even as far south as Georgia. They too have grievances.
You'll call them more than grievances if they have redcoats imposed upon them.
To send troops here. New Englanders and we should regard them as enemies. Foreign enemies. Our loyal governor says we do not have the stomach for a rumpus. He says we fear these redcoats, these lobster backs.
If he hit me, you gotta show him.
What is it?
The redcoat! He hit me right here!
Who?
The sentry hit me with his gun!
Did the savage?
If we are men, we must behave like men. We must be prepared to drop every last drop of blood.
Go after him!
Let's go! Let's kill the bloody redcoat!
England herself has trouble at home. She cannot suppress the great tumult and risings of the people on her own island. She is beset by the weaver's mob, the seaman's mob, the coal miner's mob, and some even say the clergy's mob. We must take advantage of her weakness. Rising of the people would... Is that another false alarm?
Quickly! Come quickly! The soldiers are shooting! King Street!
The Hancock brief from your office. It's ready for submission, sir.
We know yet how many were killed, Mr. Jarrett?
4, sir. And 1 wounded. Patrick Carr, the Irishman. And they say he's as good as dead. The town is boiling over. Even the people from the country are flocking in. Have you seen them in the markets, Mr. Adams, with their muskets?
Then they had better return to the country before more blood is spilled.
Show those redcoats.
You'll show them a mob, Mr. Jarrett. They'll show you a cannon. Is that what you wish?
We cannot sit quietly by and be slaughtered.
If we are to show them anything, it is that we can be law-abiding when they are not.
organize a citizens' watch committee quickly.
Mr. Adams, if you please.
I'm sorry, he can't see you.
Now, I must talk with Mr. Adams.
He's busy at the moment.
Ah, Mr. Adams.
Forrest, James Forrest.
They called me the Irish infant. We had a drink together once in the British coffee house.
What can I do for you, Mr. Forrest?
I come with a solemn message, Mr. Adams. A very solemn message indeed. For your ears alone, if I could have your ear privately.
Jared, I've seen this man before, sir. With the British Army, I would not trust him.
I am not asking you to. I don't come for myself, Mr. Adams. Believe me, I come on behalf of those poor souls in prison. As God is my witness, those soldiers are innocent of murder. They were only defending their lives from the mob.
A trial must determine that, Mr. Forrest.
There's no one will defend them. I've come to you for that reason. Josiah Quincy says he'll assist if I can engage you. Without you, he positively declined. Now, will you take the case? They cannot get counsel. No one dares represent them.
There are good lawyers sympathetic to their cause.
I've been to them all. They dare not go against the mob. But you have no fear of the mob, Mr. Adams. They're on your side.
Then they are on the side of the law.
Mr. Adams, that mob would hang those men without trial, without justice.
The soldiers will get their trial.
But if they cannot have counsel of their own choosing. Now, they have a right to that, have they not, Mr. Adams? Whatever they did, they have that right.
Don't talk to me of rights, Mr. Forrest. Talk to the men slain in Dock Square last night.
I would have thought in a free country, counsel was the one thing an accused person should not find wanting.
You forget. We ceased to be free when the soldiers were sent to occupy us.
You're free to take the case. If you do not, if the soldiers do not have counsel to represent them, the trial will not be fair. Justice will not be done, Mr. Adams. Only revenge.
Do you have a coin, Mr. Forrest?
A coin?
Any denomination will do.
Well, I have a guinea. Oh.
I will consider it my retainer.
You mean you will represent them?
You leave me no choice if I'm to respect either myself or the law.
Mr. Adams, I can't tell you.
Then please do not try. Your friends may still hang. In the massacre. I wish you to understand this from the outset. I'll defend you to the best of my capabilities, but you can expect no art or artifice, no prevaricating, no
twistering. Speak the king's English.
No lies. I will not lie on your behalf, nor even bend the truth. You can expect to be defended on fact, evidence, and law.
And a Boston jury, they can't wait to get a rope around our necks.
You'll get a fair trial, I'll promise you that.
Oh, burn in hell before that promise is kept. They've heeded us ever since we stepped off the boat. For all I know, you only took this case to make certain we'd hang.
Think what you will. I intend to defend you.
Why? For love of the British infantry? For money? We can't pay your fee. Why, you get it off, Mr. Adams, and all Boston will turn against you. What's your reason, then, huh? Are you changing sides?
Take no offense, Mr. Adams. He's upset. You can understand why.
It's my neck he'll stretch, that's why. I want to know the man that stands between me and the hangman.
Which one are you?
He's Montgomery, sir. But pay no
attention. You'll be charged with murder, Montgomery, and tried by a jury that won't like your face, your uniform, or your manners. But you'll be tried on evidence and not prejudice. I'll see to that. If you don't believe me, then I suggest you look elsewhere for counsel. After all, as you say, it'll be your neck that they'll stretch and not mine. That, my retainer.
Mr. Adams! Mr. Adams!
Help us.
I shall need a sworn statement from each of you as to what happened. And be as concise as you can. Above all, be truthful. You may be saved by the truth, but your lies will hang you. There's no other way.
The prosecution's already found 94 witnesses. Will swear that the soldiers fired without provocation. I've read some of their depositions, and I must say they make a very formidable case.
I hope to secure a postponement. Tempers must be allowed to cool.
I think the governor would agree. He doesn't want a conviction any more than we do. Also, I heard that there was a man talking to the crowd just before the shooting. Postponement would give us time to find out about him. He's described as wearing a red cloak and white wig.
Josiah, you'll be doing the questioning, but the case will be conducted by me. Your brother's prosecuting. Are you sure you want to oppose him?
I've been opposing him since we were children. He was on the side of authority even then.
I understand many are calling you lobster lover since you agreed to defend the soldiers.
Doesn't bother me.
Only a fool doesn't know his enemies from his friends. I am delighted you took the case, cousin.
I thought you'd be anxious for a conviction, Sam.
I would like to see them hang. They shot down peaceful citizens in cold blood.
That is yet to be determined.
It's about to be. But it is more important that you are representing them instead of some Tory. At least you will not bring any of the Sons of Liberty into this.
I'm going to defend those soldiers as best I can, Sam. If anyone suffers in the process, it is not my concern.
What is your concern, John?
The law.
The law serves those in power. That is the function and the purpose of the law. The only honest question is, who holds that power? The rest is hypocrisy.
I am concerned with justice for 8 men who now stand accused of murder. They can only receive justice under the law.
Justice cannot be done until injustice is corrected. Those soldiers must go back to England.
That is not the issue.
That is the issue. What England does to us is the issue. They tyrannize us. Are we expected to honor them?
Yes. Or else we are as much to blame as they. We cannot perjure ourselves.
Ours is a political cause, not a legal one. And in politics, perjury is a relative matter, a means to an end. We bend the truth so as not to bend the knee.
No, cousin. If our cause is what I think it is, it can stand the test of truth and the test of law.
We believe in liberty, John. We call ourselves the Sons of Liberty. We and other men who feel as we do. Brave men. Willing to give their lives for that belief.
Or willing to start a riot. Who stirred them up, cousin? Who was this man in a white wig that roused the crowd to such a frenzy?
He is not important to your case.
Incitement to riot is very important.
Forget that man.
If I need him for my case.
The Sons of Liberty are more important than your case. Remember that. Remember what side you're on. You cannot compromise that side. Not for 8 or 80 or 800 British soldiers.
I am going into that room to defend the lives of 8 men. Josiah Quincy will be doing the questioning. But the case will be conducted by me, and I intend to do everything that is necessary. No more, no less.
And these aforesaid soldiers, not having the fear of God before their eyes, but being moved and seduced by the instigation of the devil and their own wicked hearts, did on the 5th day of this instant march at Boston aforesaid within the country aforesaid, with force and arms feloniously, willfully, and of malice aforethought, assault one Crispus Attucks and others then and there, being the peace of God and of the said Lord the King, and did shoot off and discharge against the said Crispus Attucks 2 leaden bullets that did strike, penetrate, and wound the said Crispus Attucks in upon the right heart, a little below the right breast of him, the right Crispus Attucks, thereby inflicting 1 mortal wound of the depth of 6 inches. And therefore then, and feloniously, willfully, and of the malice aforethought, did kill and murder the said Crispus Attucks, against the peace of George III, his crown and his dignity in the 10th year of his reign.
Guards will face the prisoners in the dock.
Left turn. We march.
Section up.
do you then plead?
The defendants and all of them plead not guilty, Your Honors.
God send you a good deliverance. Gentlemen of the jury, look upon the prisoners and hearken to your charge. Upon each and every one of these several indictments, the prisoner at the bar have pleaded not guilty. Good men and true, stand together and hearken to your evidence.
Will the prosecution open its case?
Lords, members of the jury, we have here before you a case involving murder. Well, I heard a great big noise. My wife said, go to the door and find out what the matter is. I did, and I saw 20 people coming through Boylston Alley.
Did you see any soldiers?
Yes, sir, I saw 7 or 8 soldiers coming from the main guard without coats. They were riding along, swearing and cursing like wild creatures, saying, where are they? Cut them to pieces. Slay them all.
What did you do?
Well, I went into the house and shut the door, and they went around King Street.
Is that all?
Yes, sir.
Your witness.
Mr. Thayer, did you see any of these prisoners there?
No, sir, I can't fix on any man.
Did the townspeople in the alley say anything?
Yes, sir, they cried fire, which I took to mean a watchword.
A watchword for what?
Well, to ring the bells as a fire alarm.
And was there, in fact, a fire at that time?
No, sir.
Could the people have yelled fire just to start the bell ringing and confuse the people?
I do not know that, sir. I only know there was no fire.
No more questions. Someone asked the soldiers, are your guns loaded?
Who asked the soldiers, are your guns loaded?
Pardon, sir?
Who asked the soldiers, are your guns loaded?
Oh, well, I couldn't tell whether it was soldiers or inhabitants. And then I heard the word to fire, distinctly, twice. And then the shot came from the gun, sir.
What did you do then?
Then I looked at this man, and I bade him not to fire. But he did, and Samuel Gray fell at my feet. And then Kilroy immediately thrust his bayonet through my coat and my jacket.
Well, did Gray throw anything at Kilroy before he fired?
No, sir. He had no weapon in his hand. He was naked as I am now, sir.
Did people throw anything at the soldiers?
No, sir. Nothing was thrown. No blow was struck. Nobody offered to strike one.
Witness.
Master Hemingway, you stated you did not know who it was who asked the question, are your guns loaded? No, sir, I couldn't tell. But, Master Hemingway, you have sworn that you heard the command to fire twice distinctly.
Aye, sir, I heard him say fire.
Isn't it a fact that you heard the inhabitants shout fire not once or twice, but perhaps 100 times that night?
Aye, sir.
Then you are not sure that an officer gave the command to fire at all.
Well, I couldn't swear to that, sir.
He probably knows who had those bells rung. Oh, but we don't need that. The jury will realize those bells were rung for a purpose.
Mr. Bridgham, do you recognize any of the prisoners standing at the bar?
No, that man there at the end.
Hugh Montgomery.
Aye, if you say so.
When did you last see Mr. Montgomery?
He's standing next to the sentry box on King Street, the night of March 5th last.
Was he armed?
Aye.
How near were you to him?
Oh, I was about 4 feet off, about 4 feet. And he said to me, damn you, stand off. And he pushed his bayonet at me. So I stood off. And he fired.
At you?
At all the people.
Strange he wasn't injured 4 feet away. Well, we must ask him.
Were the people throwing things?
There was a snowball or two.
No bricks? No pieces of wood? No oyster shells?
I saw none.
Did you apprehend then that Mr. Montgomery or any of the accused was in any danger from anything you saw?
I did not indeed.
Thank you, Mr. Bridgham.
Mr. Bridgham, you say a soldier pushed at you with his bayonet. Did he stab you?
No, sir.
You were very lucky, sir. How do you account for the fact that he did not stick you with a bayonet? Did you run away?
No, sir. I pushed it aside with what was in my hand.
And what was in your hand?
In my hand?
What was it that you had in your hand, Mr. Bridgham?
Oh, in my hand. It was a Highland broadsword.
A Highland broadsword. Do you customarily carry such a weapon?
Well, my wife said, if you're going out, take this. Oh, I took it.
A broadsword. Well, the jury must realize what his intent was at the scene.
Mr. Hinkling, please describe what you did immediately after the shots were fired.
I saw the soldiers pushing at the bodies with their bayonets. I ran over to one, and I saw the blood gushing out of his head, so I reached down to find the wound, and I found a hole as big as my hand. This, I later found out, was Samuel Gray. I then went over to the mulatto, Crispus Attucks, found him gasping. I lifted his head out of the gutter. I left him. I went back to the soldiers. I asked them what they thought of themselves to lie men wallowing in their blood as they did. And they answered, damn them, they should have stood aside.
Well, have the people provoked the soldiers into firing?
I heard no affront to the soldiers other than the boys whistling in the streets.
This kind of testimony is dangerous. He's lying. But the jury is clearly moved. We'll have to prove to the jury just how great the provocation of the soldiers was.
Yes, several. There's Kilroy. I know him particularly well.
Did you ever hear Kilroy make use of any threatening expressions against the inhabitants of this town?
Yes. I heard him say he would never miss an opportunity to fire at the inhabitants. And he said he'd hoped for such an opportunity ever since he landed here.
I went to see what was the matter. There were some people talking to the sentry. Then there came out about 20 soldiers with cutlasses in their hands, and they were coming after me. And I said, soldiers, don't kill me. And one of them said, that one there, I would swear to it. He said, no, we'll kill you all. And he struck at my head.
It would have been better if the whole people had risen and insisted on the removal of the army than to take upon themselves the consequences of exciting such passions between children and the soldiers.
And when I got to the town pump, they said the sentry had knocked down a boy.
Do you recognize the sentry?
Yes, he's that man there.
What were the boys and young men doing while you were there?
Well, they were swearing and speaking bad words, but they threw nothing.
And what did that sentry do?
Well, the sentry went up on the steps and called out, but what he said I do not remember. Then the soldiers came out, and from where I stood I could not see them load, but I heard someone say, are your guns loaded? Then immediately a gun went off. Now, I was within reach of their guns and bayonets, and one of those fellas thrust at me with his bayonet and run it right through my jacket and greatcoat.
What were you doing before you were thrust at?
I was but standing there.
And when the gun went off?
Well, I pointed to that man, and I looked him in the face, and I bid him not to fire.
What were your very words?
I said, damn you, do not fire.
And what did he do?
Immediately, he fired.
And I saw Kilroy with the others. And I saw his bayonet bloody. The blood dried 5 or 6 inches from the point. I was as nigh to him as I am to you. And it was blood on his bayonet. I could not mistake it. I've seen enough blood in my time. It was blood.
As near as I am to you. We shall see.
Mr. Croswell said he could see Gilroy's bayonet covered with blood. You cannot possibly see the sentry post clearly at this distance. Certainly not with people in front of him.
And at night, remember.
I hope Mr. Croswell is better at his trade than he is at his lies.
I shall cross-examine him thoroughly tomorrow. Do not worry. But do you think it's best to start with our own witness, Wilson?
Yes. We must start our own case.
It was they who started the trouble, I wager.
They're only children.
They imitate the town.
The town is not on trial, Josiah. Remember that. Do not blend together two things so essentially different as the guilt and innocence of Boston and those soldiers. You will deal strictly with the evidence of the soldiers. No stirring up of the jury against the townspeople.
Sewell takes you for one of his people now.
What I am, Mr. Quincy, does not depend upon what people take me for.
You said you happened to be before Murray's barracks at that hour. Had you gone there alone, Mr. Croswell?
No, I was with friends.
Did you carry sticks?
Well, we were taking a walk. We carried walking sticks.
And where were you and your friends immediately prior to this?
We were standing, listening to...
Listening to what, sir? Or should I say to whom?
We were listening to a man talking.
And do you remember how this man was dressed?
I think he wore a red cloak and a white wig.
And did his remarks stir you in any way?
I do not remember.
Do you at least remember who this man was? And surely you remember that.
I do not remember.
I submit you do remember. I submit that you and your friends and that man in the red cloak and white wig were in that square on that night, not by accident, but by design. And that design was to inflame the citizens against the soldiers. And I ask you again, sir, on pain of perjury, who was that man?
Your lordships, will you indulge me a few minutes to consult with Mr. Quincy? I request a brief moment to consult with counsel.
Very well.
You will stop that line of questioning, Josiah.
But he was about to answer.
We can prove incitement to riot.
All you have to prove is provocation of the soldiers at the scene. There is no need to identify that man. Liberty are not on trial, Josiah. Remember that.
But we can destroy the prosecution's case.
We can destroy our cause.
We excuse the witness, Your Honor.
Well, you sir, who's in our favor? You betray us now? Is that what you do to us? Is that why you took our case? You want to see us hanged? They want to see us hung?
Our case now. We can prove the crowd was an unlawful assembly and that the soldiers fired in self-defense. A judgment of death against the soldiers will be as foul a stain on this country as the execution of the Quakers and witches anciently.
And when I came to Green's Lane, I met numbers of people. They were all shouting and they all had sticks in their hands.
What sort of sticks, Mr. Wilson?
Uncommon sticks. As if they'd pulled them out of the hedges. They headed for the sentry. They said they'd do for the soldiers this time. They said they'd go after them, and they'd kill them all.
And so I followed after the crowd. And when they came to the sentry, they shouted, "This is the fellow." And there was a man standing next to me, and he had a cudgel in his hand. And he said he would throw the cudgel at the sentinel. I said, "Do not, for he will fire."
And what did the man do?
He threw it. He threw the cudgel at the sentinel.
Who then fired?
No, sir. Not then. There was no firing until after many sticks were thrown.
The numbers of people were increasing. I was afraid that this sentry was in danger. I thought that if he didn't lose his life, he'd be lucky. The people were yelling, "Kill him! Kill him!"
Good. Our witnesses are giving sufficient evidence that the sentry fired in self-defense. The next one should settle it.
Some oyster shells at them. And the boys were throwing pieces of ice. What sort of pieces? Were they small or were they large enough to hurt a man?
They were hard and large enough to hurt any man.
Dr. Jeffries, you were Patrick Carr's surgeon.
I was, along with others.
You attended him from the time he was shot until he died.
I did.
Did he say to you anything at all about the circumstances of the shooting?
Well, he said he went solely out of curiosity.
Carr blamed himself for going to the riot with a design against the soldiers. The jury will surely believe the words of a man just stepping into eternity.
There were oyster shells and ice.
I asked him if he thought the soldiers had been abused a great deal. He said yes. He said he'd often seen soldiers fire on the people in Ireland, but had never seen them endure half as much as they had that night in Boston.
When did you last talk to him?
About 4 o'clock in the afternoon, preceding the night that he died.
And what did he tell you then?
He said he forgave the man, whoever it was, that shot him. That he was satisfied that he had no malice and had fired to defend himself.
Thank you, sir.
The laws of society, gentlemen, lay a restraint on the passions of men so that no man shall be the avenger of his own cause unless through absolute necessity, the law giving a just remedy for every wrong. If a man might at any time execute his own revenge, there would be an end of law. The facts in this case are fully proved, and until something comes up to remove from your minds the force of that evidence, you must pronounce these unfortunate men guilty.
May it please your worships, and you gentlemen of the jury, I am for the prisoners at the bar, and shall apologize for it only in the words of the Marquis Beccaria. If I can be the instrument of preserving one life, his blessings and tears of transport shall be sufficient consolation to me for the contempt of all mankind. Now the sun is not about to stand still or go out, because there was a mob in Boston on the 5th of March that attacked a party of soldiers. These things are not new in this world, nor in the British Dominions. Though they are a comparative novelty in this town, we needn't concern ourselves with whom this mob represents. They represent only themselves. Still, they did attack the soldiers. If, upon the whole, by comparing the evidence, you should find that the soldiers are a lawful assembly at the custom house, and that they did behave properly whilst there, and did not fire until there was a necessity to do so in their own defense, and if you should find that the people collected around the soldiers were an unlawful assembly and had a design to endanger, indeed to take away the lives of the soldiers, that seems to be evident, then you must find the soldiers innocent. Gentlemen, to your candor and justice, I submit the prisoners and their cause. I ask that as befits custom and common law, the guilty receive as punishment that which is called benefit of clergy.
Granted. Fetch the heated iron.
Yes, Your Honor.
You, Montgomery. I, Cook Kilroy. Stretch out your left hand. Prisoners at the bar, the verdict has been confirmed and the sentence is carried out by branding you on the brawn of your left thumb. You are hereby discharged from the jurisdiction of the Crown. This court now stands adjourned.
God bless you, Mr. Adams.
We owe our lives to you.
I'm sorry about your comments.
A small price, Mr. Adams.
Thank you.
A small price indeed.
Come in. Jonathan.
My compliments. A splendid victory.
Thank you.
I'm really happy.
John, if you'd care to meet me at the club, I have some friends I'd very much like you to meet.
They remain your friends, Jonathan, not mine.
John, my compliments.
I think we've both won, cousin.
Of course, nothing has changed. The violence will continue until our rights are recognized.
There is still time for reason.
Not as much time as you think.
John Adams risked his whole career in defending the soldiers. In spite of his unpopular stand, he was elected to the General Court. He became one of the great public figures of America, one of the original signers of the Declaration of Independence. He became the second president of the United States.
These stories of past courage can teach, they can offer hope, and they can provide inspiration. But they cannot supply courage itself. For this, each man must look into his own soul.